Once again, I bid you welcome if you're inside. I bid you welcome if you're outside in the field. I bid you welcome if you're looking over this video at us this morning. We are just delighted you're here. If you came looking for God, He's here today. I hope you feel blessed by His presence. I hope you feel a little bit of His love. And I hope you feel sprinkled by His hope. If this season, in fact, this is going to be a wonderful, wonderful Christmas service today. A couple things to announce to you today. For those of you that are members, some of you that, if I have your email, you're going to be getting an email about something called Right Now, which is an educational video service that I want to start introducing to the church. It will be free for you to use, but it has a lot of educational videos to learn things about the Bible, to do Bible studies by yourself, to lead a Bible study, whatever. There will be a lot more information coming in the future weeks, so just stay tuned for that. In your bulletin, there's a flyer about two events that I want to point out to you specifically. We're doing a Christmas Eve service on Christmas Eve, shock, shock, at 6 o'clock. And this year, this is brand new. We're going to do a blue Christmas service on Tuesday, December the 21st. If you've never heard of a blue Christmas service, the variety that we're going to have is one that is focused on people for whom this may not be a happy season. And there clearly are people that are going through grief, they're depressed, they lost their job, they lost their house, they lost whatever. So it is going to be a different kind of service. It will not be a big service. Just be here for a few people that may need that kind of a service in their life this year. So stay tuned for that. If you know people for whom that kind of a service would be a benefit, please let them know. Anybody can come. And we will do a chili, soup, and salad dinner after that blue Christmas service. Next week, we will once again do our movie and lunch deal on Tuesday the 21st. So if you want to come to that, please sign up so we can plan for food for that. It's going to be a great, great movie called Christmas Child. It's not what you think. It's going to be a really great thing. In January, we are trying to plan a special baptism service. If you have people in your family, you know people in your neighbors that have never been baptized, let me know about that. Tell them about our desire to do a baptism service, so we'll try to baptize people that have never been baptized in January. So just reach out to me and find out more information about that. And finally, the prior calendars that we've had indicated an event at our church this coming Friday night at 6 for the Better Day Daycare Center concert. It is at 7. So the concert on Friday is at 7. That was a misprint in the prior calendar. But I hope you'll enjoy the things that we've got planned and coming up. More importantly, I hope you'll keep your eyes on the season and while we're doing this. It's going to be a great, great season. This is a great place to be. Miss Judy Williams, how are you today?
Doing good.
I haven't seen you for a long time. Yeah, if I say in the end days, would y'all know what that means? Y'all may not know that term. But anyway, it's good to see everybody. With that, we'll begin our service.
As we begin our worship service today, a couple of themes you'll notice today while we're worshiping God. One of them is joy. Our Advent candle focuses on the joy that we receive during this time of year. And along with that, our pastor's sermon is, if you've looked at the title in the bulletin, The Road Less Traveled, that journey that takes us to God, that spiritual journey that all of us travel one way or another. So that will also be a theme. And of course, if you travel that journey pretty well, then you get a lot of joy. Let's stand and sing together the doxology as we begin our service.
Praise Him, all creatures here.
the name of your Son, Jesus. And we ask that you would grace us with your Holy Spirit today. May your presence and your Spirit be with us all. May we receive a blessing from simply having taken the time out of our lives to be here, to acknowledge you, to acknowledge our Lord Jesus, to sing, to pray, to hear your word. May it all bring both joy and blessing to each one of us and to all that we love. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Please be seated. One
last thing. We want to really thank Kay Barron for coming and singing for us today. He's going to sing. You need to realize that we have a really special relationship with Kay. Wilbert Hart was scheduled to sing today, and he had a death in the family, and he's up in Georgia, and so he's not able to come and sing. So what do you do when these things happen more or less at the last minute? What the guy who's in charge of scheduling singers, what is a guy supposed to do?
Go to second best.
Go.
No. We ain't going there.
We go to the guy we can count on. That's who we go to. We go to Kay. Thank you.
Boy, it's great to see everybody here today. Even some young people must be. You didn't tell them I was going to sing, did you?
They didn't know.
That's why they came.
Okay.
Well, I'm going to start off just real quick with a poem. It's kind of prophetic, I think, for this time, called Mary Had a Little Lamb. Mary had a little lamb, his fleece was white as snow. And everywhere that Mary went, the lamb was sure to go. He followed her to school each day. It wasn't even in the rule. He made the children laugh and play to have a lamb in school. And then the rules all changed one day, illegal it became, to bring the Lamb of God to school or even speak his name. Every day got worse and worse, and days turned into years. Instead of hearing children laugh, we heard gunshots and tears. What must we do to stop the crime that's in our schools today? Let's let the Lamb come back to school and teach our kids to pray.
I thought that was a great poem.
Well, I was asked to say something about love, and any time you think about Jesus, I think it's always love. And as far as I'm concerned, my love is that Jesus went to the cross, and the cross is all the proof I need. If I never get to see the signs and wonders, if the miracles I pray for never came, there'd be no cause to doubt the love of Jesus, 'cause his love for me is faithful just the same. The cross is all the proof I need. The nails, the blood, a hill called Calvary. No greater love was given than this, so I believe. The cross is all the proof I need. I am blessed beyond what I could have imagined, for his favor finds me everywhere I go. But if I walk a road of tragedy and sorrow, I would still sing, Jesus loves me as I go. The cross is all the proof I need. The nails, the blood, my guilt on Calvary. No greater love was given than this, so I need. The cross is all the proof I need. All I really need to know is how far love would choose to go to purchase love for me, I believe. The cross is all the proof I need. The nails, the blood, a hill called Calvary. No greater love was given than this, so I need. The cross is all the proof I need. The cross is all the proof I need. And light this. Y'all, come on up. The wreath is over here, which you clearly can see. This is the Lauer family. And I don't know who's going to read and who's going to do anything else. But we are delighted to have everyone. Who's going to listen to do the lighting? So we get in sync on this. We're lighting
two purple candles and one pink candle today. Doesn't make any sense, but that's the way it is. Two purple, one pink. I'll let you guys know.
This is going to be a reading from Matthew 2, verses 10 through 11. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshipped him. Then they opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh.
Miss Sue, would you like to tell us who your family is up here?
Yeah. My son Gregory, my son Brian, Gregory's daughter, my granddaughter, Sarah, Janet, Brian's wife, and his daughter, my other granddaughter. This is Greg's wife, and this is my daughter, Erin, and her fiance, Wade. They came down from Minnesota and left 21 inches of snow.
Guys, I'm so sorry we weren't up there with you.
Happy when you're real with us.
Nice to have you.
As our young folks depart from this room for their Sunday school class, let's sing together, Jesus Loves Me, okay?
Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong, they
sing Joy of the World, right? How you not? It's 246 in your hymnal. I need to get the words from my hymnal. And I need it before we start. Before you stand back here.
No, I need it.
Okay. I'm taller when I stand back here.
Wait just a minute. Wait just a minute. Yeah, but I gotta know. Okay, that's one, two, and the last, right? Yeah. Something didn't happen. There we go.
We're going to sing the first and the second and the fourth stanza because we're singing with recorded music, and sometimes you don't have many choices, and there's some breaks up. You just have to do what you have to do. How about if you stand and sing? I think people say, this is a great song. You can sit down after we, if you're able, and if you feel like it. Yeah, let's stand and let's sing today.
Joy to the world.
She wanted me to pick up my mic. Joy to the world. We'll get you started when the time comes. Songs were set too high, and I can't sing a word clip. So we're going to sing stanza one in English. That's what if you want to sing Latin. That's fine. My mother used to do that. And two, and then we're going to sing stanza two, and then we're going to sing what's listed here as stanza three, and that'll be it. Okay, because that's what we know is the last stanza. Sing choirs of angels.
Oh, you don't have that. That's okay.
Okay, let's go.
Glory to God,
know that Tom Beckman has been moved to Alliance Rehab Center in downtown DeLand. Sue, his wife, would love to be able to go and see him, but she can no longer drive. And so if you would be willing to pick up Sue and take her to see Tom one day this week, then would you let me know sometime today so I can set up a schedule for next week? That would be greatly appreciated. I also just found out that Elaine Kraft is doing rehab over at John Knox. I assume that's in the Majestic Oaks. Elaine lives literally two houses down. She and her husband Tom have been members of our church for quite some time, so just to let you know that. And finally, we just need to keep in our prayers all the many families, communities that have been just horrifically devastated with all the tornadoes that have been going through our country this past week. It's really, really been a mess. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Gracious and loving God, in times of trouble and despair, teach us and lead us to a new future with love and hope. Help us prepare our hearts and our minds this coming Advent so we can become instruments of love and peace in our world, full of hurting people. Keep our hearts soft. Keep our responses gentle. Coat our words with love and filter our vision so that we can only see the good in people. Join with me now as we say together our Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Lord, open our hearts and our minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word is proclaimed, that we may hear what you would have us to listen to today. One of you will be getting a message from God today. Will it be you? For some scriptures today, I want to share with you parts of three scriptures. The first is from the book of Matthew, chapter 22. Jesus also told them other disciples. He said, "The kingdom of heaven can be illustrated by the story of a king who prepared a great wedding feast for his son. And when the banquet was ready, he sent his servants to notify those who were invited, but they all refused to come. So he went and sent out other servants, that the feast was prepared. The bulls and the fatted cattle have been killed and everything is ready. Come to the banquet. But the guests he invited ignored them, went their own way, one to his farm, another to his business, and others seized the messengers, insulted them, and killed them. For many are called, but few are chosen." And then perhaps a more familiar single line piece of scripture. This is Luke 9, chapter 23. "Then he said to them all, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross daily and follow me." And then in Jeremiah chapter 6, verse 16, this is what the Lord says: "Stop at the crossroads and look around. Ask for the old godly way and walk in it. Travel its path and you will find rest for your soul. You reply, no, that's not the road we want. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. So what road are you on today? And where are you headed? In a book called The Road Less Traveled, author Scott Peck begins with a blunt and pretty catching statement, life is hard. He doesn't sugarcoat it. And he goes on to deal with the illusion that so many people would like to believe that life is supposed to be easy. For Peck, dealing with the reality of hard living is a road less traveled. The road toward priorities and goals is a road to avoid for many people, not a road to follow. Few people these days have the patience and perseverance to tackle such objectives. Peck suggests that our best strategy is just to acknowledge the reality of the challenge before us and get on with it. And yet he would point out that too many people mope and moan through their life rather than pursuing solutions and searching for ways to overcome and solve. He offers the view that too many seem to want a handout rather than a hand up because they cannot rid themselves of the false reality in which they live that says their life should be easy. The reality is that life is a series of problems. What are we going to do about them becomes the issue. And of equal importance to Peck is the question of what are we teaching our kids? The mindset of moping and moaning, or the mindset of resolving and overcoming? For many, challenges are met with eager anticipation to engage and resolve. If you look at a sports team that's about to face the playing of one of their big opponents, if they're a good athlete, they're going to be eager to get into that game and eager to show what they can do and eager to win that game. But for many others, such challenges are met with an attitude of surrender, an attitude of giving up, an attitude of I can't do that, and some even refuse to try. The issue is real. It is alive, it is well in our society. Too many people walk around the broad road of defeatism rather than the narrow road of achievement and accomplishment. It has a profound impact on the people with such attitudes, as well as our youth. Because teaching kids now to face problems, to solve problems, to accept responsibilities for the problems they create is an absolutely great way to produce healthy, well-balanced, and faithful young men and women. Not kids that are prone to head to drinking and drugs and other kinds of things in which they believe their problems will simply go away and disappear. The problems don't just go away. Problems and resources are usually required to build a framework that leads to a solution. And ignoring problems doesn't get it done. Some kids, some adults, still believe in the get-rich-quick mentality, which is simply a disease. Our society that's bent on instant gratification continues to push such thoughts away from what I was taught, which is slow and steady wins the race. The respectable approach of self-discipline these days has been pushed to the side. It is a road less traveled. Peck is a proponent of the well-known view that healthy people take responsibility for their actions. There's an old expression, if it is to be, it's up to me. And while I think that statement has a lot of merit, I would quickly add that we need to factor into that statement the reality that a lot of cultures these days are team-oriented. And so it is the team that needs to make the decision to step up and help. Yogi Berra is quoted as saying, when you get to a fork, what?
Take it. Some of you are reading sports center.
Now that is a really humorous comment. I'm not sure it's the greatest advice. Scripture offers a better alternative in that reading in Jeremiah. This is what the Lord says. Stop at the crossroads and look around. Ask for the old godly way and walk in it. Travel its path and you will find rest for your soul. But the people in Israel who were responding to that quote decided not to do that. They said, no, that's not the road we walk. The significance of that piece of scripture is huge. In Jeremiah's time, the nation of Israel was basically ignoring God completely. And as we head toward a new year, surely it must be a time for us to re-examine our own lives. And what's going on with us? And how are we going to change next year? Now, predictably, some of you are going to say the following. Some of you are going to say, yeah, I need to lose weight. Any hands? I need to exercise more. I need to stop smoking. I need to eat better food. Keep going. I need to stop hurting my ankle. Those are predictable paths that people can take. You know, I'm delighted you guys are here today. It's exciting. An active period of our church right now, if you're somewhat new to our church, and I trust that you will, by coming here, find a way to connect to God. And you'll get involved in some of our ministries and you'll benefit from some of them. Next year we're going to offer a whole slew of new ministries that I think you'll be excited about. It is a place to come and receive the good news. You are in the right spot. In our church, attendance is up. Membership is up. Financial giving is up. If you read about a lot of other churches, we are an exception. We are blessed. In a magazine called Christianity Today, there was recently an article that I think you'll find interesting. It talked about the public health crisis that is soon to face America. Soon to face America. And it goes on to talk about the fact, from one author's perspective, was a pastor who claimed that the church saved his life because of the social relationships and a lot of faith that the church provided to him in a period of his life when he was sick. That article goes on to say something really important, and I bet you're going to want to hear it. It says that people that attend church regularly have healthier and better lives than the general population. Now, this is a scientific study, a fairly large size. Now, if you've been around the Christianity world a while, you've heard similar comments before, but nevertheless, it is good to have that reaffirmed. Going to church is good for us. But the author, more importantly, goes on to say that if we look at what's going on in our country, he says, I quote, the growing disaffection with organized religion isn't just bad news for the church. also represents a pending public health crisis. That's pretty strong words. But I wonder if it's true. Because if you look at it in the world and what's going on and where people are in their lives, there's a lot of truth in the belief that people that don't go to church don't have a lot of the stability, the relationships, the faith that can drive their futures. So you're in the right spot. This study went on to indicate that that people in church are 29% less likely to become depressed. And here's a startling statistic. People in church are 5 times less likely to commit suicide. That speaks well on the role of the church in the mental health of the people who go there. Christians are on the right road. It's not a road that is traveled much. It is a road less traveled, but nevertheless, it is the right road. Jesus began his ministry with 2 words.
I'm on fire.
Those 2 words were follow me. As he encouraged his disciples to become followers and stay with him so that he could teach them and train them and build a new life for them. He still calls us today. Oz Guinness wrote a book called The Call, in which he says, a Christian is someone who, in this life, is always on the road as a follower of Jesus. That's a good definition. Many years ago, there was a Federal Reserve chair by the name of Arthur Burns. He was a Jew. But if not, they had a prayer breakfast at the White House in his day. He used to go to prayer breakfasts on a regular basis. And one day he was asked to issue the closing prayer. Most of his participants and peers in this were Christians. Arthur stood right up and he said this prayer. He said, Lord, I pray you would bring Jews to know Jesus. And I pray you would bring Muslims to know Jesus. Then he added, and I pray you would bring Christians to know Jesus. His refreshing honesty and directness was well accepted on the hill, and that prayer is still talked about today. It has a lot of truth in it. Another author by the name of G.K. Chesterton adds this. This is important. The Christian faith has not been tried and found wanting. The Christian faith has been found difficult and untried. In other words, it is a road less traveled, even by those who would claim to be Christians today, but whose life may not demonstrate their faith. Jesus pierces our excuses about why we don't live our faith in Luke 6:46 when he says, why do you call me Lord, Lord, and do not do what I said? How many Christians start down the right path, the right road, but then they fall away? They drop out. They get distracted by other worldly matters in their life. We would do well to reclaim an important line of scripture that we heard this morning. Then he said to them all, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross lost it. Maybe you left it somewhere. But pick it up again and do what Jesus told his disciples to do when he looked them in the eye. He said, follow me. I'm going to run out here and follow him. That invitation may lie unopened as a letter at your house. An invitation not acknowledged. An invitation not accepted. An invitation left sitting there. Like the invitation issued by the king as an invitation to his wedding feast for his son. And no one came. Where is your invitation this morning? Jesus told us there are two ways to go. One path goes to hell, and one path goes to heaven. And he further tells us that he is the way. Adding in Matthew 7:13, enter by the narrow gate. For wide is the gate, and broad is the way that leads to destruction. And there are many who go in by it. But narrow is the gate, and difficult is the way which leads to life. And there are few who find it. The road to heaven is a road less traveled. And as you look at our society and the values of the people out there and look at their guiding principles of their life, it's hard to believe the accuracy of that. Proverbs 14:12 adds, there is a way that seems right to a man, but its end is the way to death. In our do-it-your-way world, rather than God's way, there are many on the wrong path, or they're headed in the wrong direction. Billy Graham conveyed his thoughts on this topic in this way. He said, Christ did not divide men and women into rich or poor, black or white, educated or uneducated. He divided them into those on the broad road to destruction and those on the narrow road leading to eternal life. That road is narrow. The gate is narrow. And Jesus is the gate. He is the one gate. He is the only gate. The road to heaven is the one that you want to be on. And once you get on it, it's the road you want to stay on. Where are you headed this morning? Do you have a plan? Do you know where you're going? There is a plan. It's called God's Word. The Bible teaches us that we must turn away from sin and trust Jesus as our Savior and follow Him as our Lord. The right path, the one less traveled, is the one where we follow Jesus to heaven. And I invite you this morning, if you want to get on that road, that you decide to do so, because it only takes a decision on your part. Give up your old life. Accept Jesus as your Savior. Come up after the service, and I'd be happy to pray with you and talk about your decision to do that. There's no better time to make a decision like that than right now, today. We'll close with this benediction. We leave today knowing that God travels with us. He is our shepherd. He is our redeemer. He walks before us. He stands beside us. He trails behind us. He hovers over us. He lifts us up. He knocks at the door of our hearts. He never, ever leaves us. May you grow in grace this week and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be the glory both now and